protection of consumers, from the protection of even for developers, I think it will bring discipline and organized. The real estate sector being a bit unorganized sector, it should become organized sector after the real estate regulatory bill be passed. Companies Act, we can discuss about hours and hours about new Companies Act. A lot of changes from investor protection perspective, disclosure perspective, financial controls, risk management, internal audit, statutory audit, auditor's rotation. Huge thing. I think it does serve the purpose, to my mind. The devil would be in detail in terms of implementation of the new Companies Act provisions. As an auditor, I can see that there are teething issues. There are going to be compliance issues. There are going to be compliance costs. The companies will have to be prepared for this. But to my mind, looks much better. Even whether it eases the doing of business in India, I'm not sure. But some controls are better than no controls in that sense. Then we have IFRS and Ind AS. Lastly, again, quite positive in line with international principles that the companies, listed companies and companies of net worth exceeding 500 crores will have to prepare their accounts in accordance with IFRS or Indian accounting standards, as they are called. Again, from this year onwards, actually next year onwards, but for the previous year figures, you need to have these figures recast as per IFRS or Ind AS. Very, very positive to my mind. Again, it will involve a lot of compliance cost, a lot of hard work to recast and to restate the accounts under IFRS, but that would really increase the confidence of the foreign investors in the Indian financial statements prepared by the corporate. So, all in all, to my mind, policy paralysis seems to have ended, moving in the right direction. A lot more things to be done, especially in the form of implementation. A good intent, but implementation has to be seen. So, that's my take on the regulatory reforms. Thank you very much. I tried to cover the three main aspects which were assigned to me, budget proposals, tax developments and regulatory reforms. All in all, looks like good, moving in the right direction. The intent is there, that we will be in detail to implement these provisions. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Puneet. I must say that you have done a wonderful job in this given 20 minutes to bring to us the predominant issues and predominant things which we wanted to look through your presentations, and we wanted to know about it. We will preserve the questions for a few more minutes. Till such time, we have the presentation from the registry. We'll request you to please present. I must tell you what Rajeshri is going to speak is one of the most important and interesting subject. In fact, we're back in November 2012, me and Jameel, and then with Vishal from PwC, spoke on tax accounting standard in CNBC TV18, and that is still doing the rounds. And Rajeshri, personally, I'm looking forward to your presentation. And you will be having roughly about 15 to 17, 18 minutes.
Sure.
And then we will have a question and answer session.
Thank you so much, ma'am. The next speaker is Rajeshri Samnavis. She is a partner with BMR and Associates LLP based in Mumbai. Specializes in tax advisory, transaction tax matters. She has over 20 years of experience in advising clients on their cross-border acquisitions and implementing the Indian business strategy for multinational. She has worked with Indian multinational in the IT sector. With regards to the transfer pricing across jurisdictions, including working on cross-border restructuring and acquisitions. She has also advised companies in the manufacturing, logistics, pharmaceuticals and ITES sector in implementing their greenfield projects, while she has advised companies in the ITES sector, auto, industry and consumer segment. I believe we have rich, you know, experienced experts on panel. May I request Ms. Ayushri Sarnavas to present her paper. Thank you.
Thanks, Sanskrit. Good afternoon, everyone, and greetings to the panel as well. The topic, I will really say allotted, but that is something which we picked up. We said that, okay, let's talk about income computation and disclosure standards. Clearly, if, you know, when I saw the theme, which speaks about monetary policy and industrial growth, as monetary policy, given the fact that you have Kotak, I said that's the banker's job, let's not put our head into it. We then focus on industrial growth, again, where you have captains of the industry who essentially would be focusing on, you know, the operational aspect. So what do we do and what do we talk as tax? We said, okay, let's take a step back. Let's look at what was the agenda for us as a country. Clearly it has been outlined. It's been in the world fora. Everybody, including everybody's watching us. Okay, let's face that. So you had the Prime Minister who actually led the growth path. He said, okay, what's the objective? Then you had the Finance Minister who presented the budget, which spoke about most of the regulatory changes and some of the new legislations that have been or proposed to be introduced, which was also covered by Puneet. One big step was essentially that recognition of the fact that every problem cannot be addressed through tax or tax reforms alone. And I think that recognition and the fact acknowledging was seen in this year's speech when you saw the Finance Minister essentially making certain announcements, especially in the black money the bill, and also the fact that there are steps being taken in the right direction. So with the objective of achieving industrial growth, and clearly growth cannot be achieved in 1 year. It's always a 2 to 3 year agenda, right? And I think everybody recognizes that. So a little bit of patience and a little bit of, I would say, focus is something which probably everybody will be prepared and is prepared to, you know, take on themselves. So what I would do is, in fact, I've got just very few slides. What we've done is we've given what is the evolution of ICDS. We've also spoken about where, you know, what, how did this evolve? And what is the life of a, you know, CFO or a tax guy today? Very quickly, in two slides, I'll, you know, very quickly depict that. And then we'll go on to each of those ICBs, essentially just touching upon some of the issues definitely that merit attention. And why is it important? Because this is effective from the current financial year, because it's been notified on April 1, 2015. So your advance tax, which is due on June 15th, is something where you will have to pay attention to what's sitting in here. It all started with Finance Act 1995, where the central government was empowered to notify the accounting standards for computing profits and gains and income from other sources. We then went on to year 1996, wherein you had, which was the accounting standards as prescribed by the Institute, which got notified under Section 145(2) of the Income Tax Act, although they were just two accounting standards under tax, but nevertheless, so we did have accounting standards within the Act itself. Year 2003, so there was a lull between 96 and 2003. 2003 is when, again, the government had constituted a committee for formulation of accounting standards, which recommended adopting the ICAI standards without modification. But clearly, the consideration at that point of time was you maintain two sets of accounts, which was completely impractical. They also recommended making legislative amendments to plug revenue leakage. That was the intent. You then, in year 2010, you had a new committee which was constituted, wherein they wanted to harmonize the accounting standards with provisions of the Act, suggest methods for determination of book profit due to IFRS transition, suggest appropriate amendments to the Act in view of transition to the Indian Accounting Standard. In 2012, you had the report of the new committee which had placed in the public domain the tax accounting standards, what we would refer to as TAS. 2015, the new draft of the 12 income computing and disclosure standards were placed in public domain. Some in Jan 2015, CBDT notified only 10 of the ICDs out of the 12 which were placed for discussion. Very quickly, these are the ICDs that have been notified, which is accounting policies, valuation of inventories, construction contracts, revenue recognition, fixed assets, effects of changes in forex, government grants, securities, borrowing costs, provisions, contingent assets, and liabilities. The ones which have not been notified on leases and the intangibles. So intangible fixed assets or intangibles. Before I go to the brief background, I'll just skip these slides. I want to take you to one slide and then this one. So what does India Inc. look at today? You have to deal with the Indian GAAP, which is what is the way you're drawing up your accounts today. You have the ICDs, the basis for which is the Indian GAAP. Okay, so when they were formulating the ICDs, the basis has been the Indian GAAP. In AS has not been taken into consideration. Now clearly there will, Ind AS is compulsory for listed companies, and as Moin rightly articulated, that's something which companies will have to follow. So where is the gap? You have a gap between the ICS and the Ind AS. May not be substantial, but there is a gap, and this is something which needs to be addressed. So the objective is that yes, as a government, we do introduce policies, we do introduce measures in terms of trying to meet up with global expectations, and also recognizing the fact that today when you talk of India Inc., it is essentially cross-border. So we, as India Inc., there is business even in the overseas countries where you have IFRS, which is already implemented, and that's compulsory. But there are some gaps, and this is something which needs to be addressed. Hopefully, they should do it pretty quickly. I thought that was important because it's, for us, it's